audience. Research the voice we haven't heard yet, and that is what do consumers really want and what are they willing to pay for. So Lisa, maybe you can tell us a little bit about what you found out.
Sure. So over the last several years, the McKinsey Mobile Health Initiative, which is a joint initiative between our telecom and healthcare practices, has worked with both the healthcare, telecom, and public sectors worldwide to build mobile health businesses, taking the business point of view. Of particular note for today's discussion, as our moderator mentioned, we also have done a fair bit of now public research working with the GSMA on quantifying the consumer willingness to pay for a number of basic mobile health services. As you might imagine, as we roam the world, trying to bring together the telecom and healthcare and public sectors around mobile health business building, we faced a healthy dose of skepticism around the business models associated with mobile health. From the providers, skeptical about the ability of mobile health solutions to drive outcomes, payers, their ability to actually drive real cost savings, and telecom companies around their ability to build a legitimate business around healthcare. And so I thought I'd highlight, just as part of this opening, a handful of the myths from our perspective that we see in mobile health. First and foremost, and I think you've heard a number of these echoed here, first and foremost, mobile health is not a fad. Right? It delivers real outcomes which translate into legitimate and substantial business opportunity across the value chain for telecom providers as well as payers and providers. For example, our consumer research showed that about 30% of consumers in India are willing to pay $2 for a 10-minute phone consultation with a doctor, which is 10x the out-of-pocket spend they spend on their base telecom. Second, to echo my colleague to the right, mobile health is not a technology game, right? This is about driving changes to business models and changes to cultural and behavior changes worldwide. A lot of the mobile health services that are taking off around the world are using existing technology and existing care regimens, as basic as voice consultations or text and message. Prescription validation and authentication. The third myth, mobile health, and this may be a bit of a different view from what you've been seeing a lot of today, but mobile health is not just about care delivery. There are a lot of applications of mobile health that transform the overall business models in the healthcare system. For example, for a payer, having on a smartphone a portal that enables a patient to submit claims, update accounts, access information, straightforward but fundamental changes to their business model and the way that they interact with their patients. Similarly, in the home care environment, mobile-based dispatching systems that smart route nurses to the patients in an efficient and cost-effective manner. The fourth myth I'll highlight from an operator perspective, mobile health is not a niche business. Right? There is a perspective that this is a niche business. In fact, if you look across sectors, mobility is transforming a number of sectors around the world, not just healthcare. And there's a lot of analogies that can be drawn from other sectors. For example, in utilities, utility companies are deploying smart metering technologies that measure the consumption of electricity down to the minute, driving enormous efficiencies and effectiveness in the system around how you transmit and generate and deploy electricity and changes in consumer behavior around their consumption. It may seem a bit far afield, but there are similar mobility-driven transformations in retail, in banking, in many, many sectors, many of which have analogies that translate directly from a business model perspective into healthcare. And the last one I'll highlight is that that while mobile health, as we know, has broad worldwide applicability, the specific services and business models differ dramatically by geography. As we all know, right, in mature markets, it's much more around the efficiency and the delivery of care. In emerging markets, it's about the reach of care. And from our perspective and based on our research, it is in the emerging markets where we're seeing the most rapid adoption of mobile-based models for mobile health. Not surprisingly, both based on the high percentage of consumer out-of-pocket pay for healthcare services, as well as the lack of incumbent business processes and incumbent regulatory and legal hurdles associated with mobile health. However, where the real dollars are, if you're taking a business perspective, is in the mature markets, right, where the costs of care are staggering.
Lisa, thank you very much. Well, thanks to everybody on the panel. That was a great start. I think you got to see what's working, how it differs by region, what some of the bigger challenges and hurdles are. I'm going to start with a kind of a simple question. Alex mentioned the goo, which is kind of the, what do we do to get this whole thing started in any one place? And I want to quote our board member and new mHealth Alliance board member, Mohammed Yunus, who said the best way to fight poverty is to give someone a cell phone. But is that really the first thing we need to do? One, panel, do we need to put phones out there, or are they already there? And if it's not the phone that needs to be the first thing, what are the first three things that need to be in any kind of developing world successful mHealth system? And I'll throw it open for everybody just to put some things on the board here.
I would like to say first that just giving a mobile phone, so giving mobile phones to people will not solve anything. We cannot save life just giving a cell phone to a person. One of the most important thing that I have learned, and we have, our group have learned, is that first we need to carefully understand the needs of the people, because people are in the center of all of this system that we want to develop. So we need to carefully understand what are the perceptions, the values of the people, either if we're working or studying patients or healthcare providers. So we have done a lot of our time as a force trying to understand the needs of the people and the values of the people and the culture of the people. Because it has been mentioned that, you know, one system that have worked in Africa might not work in Peru, right? Or even inside Peru, you know, there are different cultural groups. So even a system that works in the jungle might not work in the Andes. So we need to do a lot of work with ethnography, bringing the social sciences, conducting focus groups, in-depth interviews, observations, carefully characterize the needs of the people. And also, we need to involve our end users since the beginning of the program, because that will help us and give us a lot of feedback on what we need to do, what we need to change, using participatory design, for example. So, usability studies are important, so trying to carefully characterize the bias of the people, the perception of the people, is very important.
I think that's a good question, actually. Everyone thinks about developing countries as being, economically challenged, and there is a huge economic divide. There's a huge health divide. If you look at the number of doctors in developing countries, it's like 1 to 50 compared with the developed countries. But obviously, if you look at the number of mobile phones, then you'll find that the ratio is just 1 to 2. So the mobile penetration in developing countries is already there. For that reason, it's always a natural move to say mHealth is about mobile phone. But I'd like to point out that actually mobile technology is not just mobile phones. A lot of the things that we do in the space of health management are in fact about remotely monitoring devices. So we use the mobile technology with the SIM card and the telecom network, but we don't really use a mobile phone. You don't need a mobile phone to just do machine-to-machine type of technology. And I'd really like to concur with what Pat and the lady from McKinsey said. Technology is sort of it's not the issue. So let's take the technology out of the picture. It's really about where do do we have a sustainable project? And if you look at a lot of what's happening in the world, there are many, many pilots, many, many experiments, very, very few scale, very, very few are sustainable and actually deploy in something which makes sense. And I think that's the greatest challenge. And why don't they get up to scale? Sometimes because people are fooled by technology and they believe that by just putting technology in there, it will help the system. That is not true. And also because sometimes you lack leadership in managing the project. To me, one essential thing is finding a project, as Walter said, but also finding a good project management. If you don't have a good project management, you waste a lot of resources.